Hello, my name is Jillian and I am a bioinformatics infrastructure consultant, and today we are going to be talking about how you can set up an image labeling platform for your high content screening data. Today I'm going to specifically be talking about C. elegans, but you could do any number of different things in here. You could do C. elegans, you could do cells, you could do pretty much anything that can be imaged and can be labeled. You could use this to set it up. So the data set that we are going to be using today is a publicly available data set. It is from the Broad BioImage Benchmark Collection, and it is 010. And what this has is this has images of C. elegans, and they have two different phenotypes, alive and dead. So that's it. So just two phenotypes, nice and easy, right? And then the program that we are going to be using is called Label Studio. It's a software that was open sourced, I think about a year ago, maybe a little bit more, and it is very nice. I've gotten into it recently, and I think of all the different imaging platforms that I've tried, this is officially my favorite. I don't have any big complaints about it, so let's get started, and I'm going to show you this. So what you do when you use this is that you have to do a bit of configuration first. With all things, you have to do a bit of configuration first. First of all, if you don't have the data set, you're gonna wanna download that. You're gonna wanna unzip it. And then, this is one of these things that I talk about a lot. So, microscope images, they're kinda weird. They tend to come out very, very dark. Like, let me show you this one. See this, what is this? We don't even know what this is. So what we do is we use a tool called Bioformats to convert from the TIFF to ping, and then use Image Magic to do an auto level correction on the ping. Sometimes you can skip that middle step. It seems to depend on the TIFF. Sometimes they have like some funny encoding and Image Magic doesn't understand them. So then you use that intermediary step. But anyways, we have this and then we convert it to a ping and it still looks funny. And then we use Image Magic. Okay, that one wasn't great, but here we go. There's this one. So let's go look at this one instead. So we have this one kind of, it shows up. I have too many files open, disease. Okay, so then this was which one was this? I think it was this one, right? Yeah, this one, that was the second image. So let's look at the second image here. Okay, so you can see here it's very, very dark. I'm not sure if it's gonna show up on the screen or not, but you can kind of very faintly see the outline of the worms. So you know that they're there, but you can't quite see them. It's not any good for using this in any other kind of imaging platform besides something like Cell Profiler or Fiji Image or, no, of course I can't remember what the other tools are, but these other tools that are made for scientific images, if you look at it through one of those, it's gonna be fine. If you're looking at it through a system viewer, it's not, so hence the auto level correction. As a quick disclaimer though, be careful when you're doing that because some of the scientific tools, they don't know how to deal with the auto level corrected. They know how to deal with the one that appears very dark. But again, we're gonna be using this in an entirely different viewer, so it's fine. So I do have a description here of how you can download the data. Let me put this, yeah, okay. How you can download the data, and then once you have the data, how you can do these different conversion commands. I'm not gonna go through all those. They're right here. If it's something that anybody is interested in, you know, you can get in touch with me. I'll leave my contact information below. And yep, that's that. And then we go down here. And then what we do is we are going to use Label Studio. So there are a few different ways that you could use Label Studio. It depends on exactly how it's configured. It is meant to be kind of a labeling platform for a lot of things. It's not even just images. There's also like audio, video. I don't know if there's anything else you can image, but who knows. So anyway, so we have two different configurations here. We have a bounding box configuration and we have a polygon configuration. What I'm gonna show you first is the polygon configuration because I think that is probably what most people are gonna be using. And also, if you do the polygon configuration, you can get a bounding box from that. Again, we'll talk about that, but let's see. So I'm just gonna grab this. If you haven't already initialized, let's go back and talk about this for a minute. So what you do is you set up your configuration file, and your configuration file is going to tell this software called Label Studio exactly what kind of labeling you want to be doing. So in this case, we want to have polygon labels, and you're going to see what those are in a second if you're already not familiar. And we are going to have two different labeling types, and these are, in this case, these correspond to our different phenotypes, which are alive and dead. And I use these different backgrounds, blue and orange. Don't use red because Label Studio uses red for other things. So just kind of a word to the wise, don't do that. You can also set some things for the controller or some, you know, some options for the image controller. So for instance, the zoom control, this is really important on these large, high content screening images because you need to be able to zoom into them. So that's that. If you don't have this, you won't be able to zoom in, which by the way, I didn't have this initially to start and I couldn't figure out where it was. And I don't know, it wasn't good. It was no good. But there we go, there's that. And then once you have that, what you do is you just initialize it. And you do that with this command here. You use the label image. I'm using the Label Studio Docker image. And with that, I am initializing. And this one, let me show you the polygon one since we're doing that. They're the same. But I am saying init polygon. And you'll see that in my directory, or yes, in my project directory, I have another directory called polygon. And I'm giving it an input path. This is the path to our images. And then I'm giving it a label config. Make sure that this is in a separate directory. I'm not sure why this is, but Label Studio assumes that it's someplace else besides like its final destination, which will be in this polygon here. And then the input format is image directory. So I'm saying here's an image directory, and then Label Studio is gonna set it all up for me. And then once you've done that, this is the initialization. It should work properly. Once we have that, then we're actually gonna run the web interface. So let's go ahead and get that one started. It will complain at me that it's not a production server. I don't care. Here we go. So if you just start it up and if you just go to localhost, because the project is already configured, it will immediately give you an image to label. And it does like a random selection of images to label. It doesn't go in any particular order, which I think you can probably configure that. Okay, so for this one, I wanna use one of one of these images here that you can see it well. Some of the other ones, the illumination is a little bit funny, which is fine. You can also label those and they work fine. Like I've used them in different models, but for this particular case, I don't think you're going to be able to see that very well on the screen. So then once we have that, we can zoom in, we can zoom out, and we can move around. So let's say, okay, we want to label this guy right here. Right here. So we're going to pick a label. I'm going to say that he's alive. I think he's alive. Well, when this image was taken, he was alive, possibly. Okay, and then I'm gonna go like this. Don't get too worried about this. You know, do a good job. You do have a little bit of editing capability after. So then we can just keep going like this. I'll do one more down here. And I will just keep on labeling this one. Okay, so then you can see, okay, this guy is labeled. It looks pretty good. If I needed to, let me go like this. Okay, so I accidentally clicked here and started another labeling task. I don't actually want that, so I'm just gonna delete it. And now I'm gonna go back on over here. And then if I need to, I can tweak these. I can move them around a little bit. I could go like this. I could say, okay, great. And then once I have that, you know, then I can move on to the next one. Oh, one kind of trick that I was a little bit stuck on is if, see, this one is highlighted, meaning it's moving, you can't start labeling. So you may think because you have this one selected, oh, you could just start labeling. No, you can't. And then one always kind of good practice is to press U, which is unselect, which just means everything else will be unselected. Otherwise, it's kind of easy to think you're doing two different labels and you're actually doing one. So then you have this one, and you know, once again, we just do the exact same thing. And we can just keep going with that. Okay, and then see, then we have this next one here, and I'm gonna say that's a bit funny. I'm gonna move this one here. and this one here. And you could even, I mean, if you needed to, you could even like zoom in even more. Okay, there you go. And then let's say I get through this one and I realize, oh no, I applied the wrong label. That's okay. I can just go over here and I can click on this other label and then see, look, now it has the other label. Unfortunately, I accidentally clicked again. There we go. Okay, and then I can zoom back out. And there we go. We can see our nicely labeled image. And then let's say I'm completely done with this image. I could press submit and there we go. And it brings me right on over to the next one. So I do want to talk, you know, now that I've gone over that, I do want to talk a little bit about how Label Studio is set up. It's set up based on this idea of having a project, and then within the project, you have different tasks. So for instance, with this one, I have apparently 200 images, and so I have 200 tasks, and of these, I have completed 4. If I was doing this, I would have two different kind of done, because you want to be able to save it as you're going along, but then you also want to have an additional maybe verified and an additional, I don't know what, or like the image is complete. So one is just I'm saving it, and then another one is it's verified or it's complete or something like that. But it's quite like extensible too. So you can make these changes if you need to, like if you need to add a button to the UI saying complete or verified or something like that, you can do that. It's all open source. So the software itself is open source and free. They have an option for hosting and for, I think, like an enterprise edition. But for what I'm showing you right now, this is open source. This is free. You can take it, you can edit it, you can do whatever you want with it. So then you can see, you know, I could go through if I need to, I can click on all these. And there we go, that's that. Once you have all these, you can go to your tasks. You can import more data if you need to. You can export. There is a setup through the UI, so this configuration file that I created, you could configure this one through the UI. I found that to be a little bit difficult. I found it easier to just work from, they have a documentation page that has a bunch of examples, and I found it easier to just kind of grab one and then just modify the actual labels. So actually let's show that quickly. So if you go to the docs are quite nice. And one of these things that they have is they have this labeling, or the template, they have templates. That's what they're called. So you can see they have a lot of different templates here. One is the image segmentation. I was taking a look at that. It looks very nice. I don't quite think it's ready for prime time. I put an issue up on GitHub because it was displaying a little bit weird. Oh, maybe it's okay now. So I don't know. So let's say this is a planet. Okay. So this is the segmentation actually. So you could do this where you have, where you have like this one, where you're using a paintbrush instead of a polygon. I personally find the polygon to be a little bit easier for me personally, but it also, I mean, it would depend somewhat on who's doing it. Like I kind of think of this as being like a very personal preference. So there you go. So you could do that and you could say, okay, this is it for this one. And then they have different, once you've done that, they have different things. So let's see. So I wonder if this one does anything. Okay, I'm not totally sure what that would do. You can create relations between different objects. You can do quite a few different things. These templates are really nice. Like if you're not exactly sure how to get your instance configured, really go take a look at the templates. They are very, very, very informative. And then one of the things that you get is you get a very nice and clear, can I get this? What is it? No, it's already maximized. Okay, we'll try like this. Okay, so see, look here, you get this very nice programmatic output, And one really handy thing about having a nice programmatic output like this is that you could use this in a retraining pipeline. So for instance, say I have my first task. I'm going to go back on over here to my C. elegans data. Okay, so I'm going to go back on over here to my C. elegans data. This output here, this is just a text file. And what you could do is you could have your first set of training data. You could train your model with it. So say you're using TensorFlow, maybe you're using the mask RCNN. I think it's two N's, it might be three N's, I'm not sure. But anyways, you use this model that lets you get these nice, they're called masks, which is really outlining the object as opposed to just drawing a box around it. So you have your first training example, you submit that, and then you say, okay, I don't want to have to do all of this work manually. So once you've trained your first model, even if it's not perfect, and it's not going to be perfect, and it's probably never going to be perfect, but you could take like an iterative approach where then you say, okay, TensorFlow, label this data the best that you can. And then from the TensorFlow output, you can create these files. These are just JSON files. So if I go and I look here, which one was this? 195. You know, this is just a JSON file. You can create this just like they did. You know, you just give it like a random string here for an ID. You are gonna know your image height and width. Yeah, all of this is generatable. If you're using the polygon labels, you would have to figure that out. But see, so you could do this. So you could have TensorFlow train your model and then say, okay, TensorFlow, go and label my next set of images. And then even if it does, you know, say it only does like 20% of the work for you, that's still 20% that's saved. Then you could go through and then maybe you get something. This is one I labeled manually. Well, all of these I labeled manually. But you know, so maybe it gets you something like this that's pretty good, and then you just go through and you label these two worms here. And then you resubmit that for the next set of training, and you can keep doing that, and over time you get a better and better and better model. So that's why I really like something like this, is because, you know, it's because the output is so easy to understand that it's very programmatic, and then you can feed that into other pipelines. And because each one of these, you know, because each one of these is labeled as a project as well, you know, you could have multiple projects. So you could, you know, you could have multiple instances of this as well and have different people labeling different data sets if you're doing any kind of crowdsourcing model, or if your crowdsourcing is that you're buying the people in the lab a pizza and just telling them to go label some data, you can do that too. You can also do these image ellipses, which are quite nice for doing cell data. So let's launch this in the playground. I don't know. It uses the same kind of image, but what this does is it creates like a star, or it creates something circular, but it's not a perfect circle, so you can kind of go like this. And you can go like this, and you could rotate it if you needed to. So this is kind of interesting, because what you could do is you could use something like, you know, like Cell Profiler to get the basic outline of your cells, get the basic outline, spit it out to this format, spit it out to a format like this here. And then once you have that, then, you know, then you could do some further training on some other model, you know, so that is kind of the point of that. You have this nice data right here. So that's kind of interesting. I find it a bit weird, though, that they use this image instead of the other image. But that's fine. Then you can do the bounding boxes. So I'll show you that one, too. Let's do the bounding boxes. Bounding boxes are handy because they're quite a bit easier to do. But then, of course, like all things, if it's easier, if it's less complicated, it's less precise. And as we all know, this kind of thing matters. But if you just wanted to do this, if you just like wanted to try this out, or maybe do this as like a proof of concept, and you just wanted to see like, oh, hey, will this even work? Could I use TensorFlow? Could I use whatever? Could I use PyTorch? Could I use SageMaker? Any of the kind of hotness. I even kind of think SageMaker under the hood. I'm not sure, but I think it might use TensorFlow. But I don't know. Oh, so one thing that's a little bit aggravating is that as soon as you click on one of these, it assumes that you're selecting it. So you have to make sure that you're selecting a bit outside of the range, which means that sometimes you'll have to just make the box in kind of a weird place. Like maybe I make it over here and then I move it and get it, you know, positioned correctly. And then there we go. Once you have that, you can submit it. Oh, it didn't get me a new one. Okay. Yeah, I don't know. I wish there was a difference between, like, I just want to save my progress and if it's complete. It might be in here somewhere and I'm just not aware of it. I think that one is alive. Okay, so there we go. So that's enough of watching me label worms. So I hope that, you know, this was interesting for you and that you can go forth and take something, you know, something like this, set it up, start labeling, start building some cool machine learning models and see what all you can learn. I do want to say I worked on this a bit as kind of a project when I was in a lab that was doing some C. elegans data, and the TensorFlow model, it did pretty well considering the kind of lack of effort that I put into it. I didn't put a ton of effort into it. I'm not a machine learning expert. I don't really know. I'm good at setting up the pipelines and things, but in terms of the real hardcore algorithm development, I don't do that. But I think the tools these days are really nice. Like you can really just take the pre-built models and train on top of them. And then from there, you know, you can get something pretty robust. So you might have these ones, and then you might have adult worms, and then you might have eggs, and you could go through and say like, okay, I want to label each one of these. In this one, we have the alive and the dead. Let's see, can we do something? Can we have one that's mostly dead? So see these ones are mostly dead. I also found with this kind of, the illumination that kind of, I don't know what, it seems to flip. Like sometimes it's light on dark and sometimes it's dark on light. This one, TensorFlow also did fine with this. So you could build, you know, you could build a TensorFlow model and just say, okay, this is the worm. But then again, once you have that, once you have the polygons anyway, so just to go back to the polygons example, if you were doing the semantic imaging, which means like you're using mask RCNN, was it this one? It's in here somewhere. There we go. So this is the instance segmentation. Okay, so see, here you go. You are actually outlining the object itself and you're getting the little bounding box. But again, you don't need to get the bounding box and the outline. If you have the outline, you can calculate the bounding box. You know, and then you can go through here and you can see that all of these, there is already a trained model. So you could just train on top of that model. I think you could also do this with PyTorch. You could try it out with the pets data set if you wanted to, that would be fine. And you could do, you could just do the object detection model. Where's the one with just the object detection? Ah, okay, so see, this is just the object detection model where you're just drawing a box. I mean, that's not gonna be great for when you have like these overlapping, like these really overlapping kind of instances, but it's pretty good. But then what was I gonna do? I was gonna talk about the polygons. So because this is just data and you know, it's just data and we can manipulate data quite a bit. One of the things is that I was kind of using the polygon as like an instance segmentation, meaning I want the actual outline of the image rather than just a box or outline of the object rather than a box around it. So then one of the things that you could do is you could take this JSON file and you could parse it and you could write a script that goes from this polygon to what is called a mask. If you're not familiar with a mask is just a matrix where every value in the matrix corresponds to a pixel in the image, and every pixel is either a 0 or a 1, meaning this is the thing that I'm looking for, or no, this is not the thing that I'm looking for. So I have a quick script that does that. I'm not going to go over that too much, but I do just kind of want to say it's using all the standard scientific Python tools. It's using matplotlib, it's using NumPy. And then also, you know, get the bounding box over here. So this is get mask. So once you have that, I'm just going to show you that you can quite easily spit this out. Oops. I think, which one was this one from? I think it was from, I don't know which one it was, but you can, this one is kind of silly because like the image is quite big and the worms are quite small, but you can see here's our mask. So the whole image is dark, and then here is the white part for the worm, and you have the whole worm. It's kind of tricky to see. I should have made a mask that was just like the clipped box, but yep, there you go. So there's the worm. There's the worm right there. And that's that. So again, once you have something like this, you have data, you can export the data, you can import the data, you can use different tools to kind of make your labeling easier. You can iterate over your processes so that you have, you know, a model, and then you use that model to label your data. And then from that labeled data, you kind of clean it up a little bit, resubmit it to the model, and then back forth, back forth, back forth. So I think this is a cool time to be doing machine learning and to go and see what, you know, what all you can label. So there you go. I will leave you with some worm images. Let's see, maybe one that I already labeled. Okay, one that I partially labeled. Good enough. So you can go through and you can carry on that fight. All right, I hope you have a good day. Bye-bye.